It's not often that I get to announce a major breakthrough in astrobiology that literally changes everything. This particular one has implications on about 3/4 of the content on this channel and is simply stunning. A team of scientists at the Foundation for Applied Molecular Evolution have literally cracked the nut of one of the greatest mysteries in science and abiogenesis. In fact, it answers the first question in a series of how life arises. Their model involves RNA and how RNA comes to be in nature. One of the major hypothetical scenarios on how life arose on Earth is known as the RNA world hypothesis. It goes like this. Scientists suspect that the first stage of abiogenesis was the formation, somehow, of RNA. RNA molecules can be self-replicating as molecules, which might have been, and in fact was if this research is confirmed, the first step towards the evolution of life and DNA. But the huge question has always been, how did RNA form? And was it a difficult process that isn't likely to happen often in the universe? Or was it a fairly straightforward process that probably happens often? I'm happy to say, if this research is confirmed, it turns out that it's so easy you can do it in a high school science class. RNA would become a very common type of molecule in the universe to the point that any terrestrial planet with volcanism has it. And while a molecule of RNA isn't life, it's merely a molecule that can store information, it dramatically increases the chance of microbial life in the universe. We don't yet know where the process of abiogenesis goes after the occurrence of RNA, but there are theories and work is being done that suggest that while complicated, it's somewhat straightforward. How it happens involves volcanic glass. Simple volcanic glass, folks. All that happens is nucleoside triphosphates percolate through volcanic glass, and out comes RNA molecules with 100 to 200 nucleotides in length. Borate, which is very common in basaltic rock, moderates the reactions. Nickel, delivered by the constant meteorite impacts of the late heavy bombardment, plays a role, as does phosphate, which is found in volcanic glass. You just need water percolating through, providing the solvent. This process is so simple and volcanic glass so common on Earth that RNA was probably occurring all over the planet in subsurface wet conditions. Previous work by the same team showed how nucleosides are formed, and that too is straightforward. In short, the landscape of moving towards Darwinian evolution is clearing, and it's turning out to be far simpler than anyone had ever imagined. If confirmed, this finding has far-reaching implications. The first is for Venus and Mars. They too would have almost certainly had RNA spontaneously forming under the same conditions as Earth. In fact, at Mars, below the surface in aquifers, it may still be occurring. And it's probably not a bad idea to check our meteorite collections for RNA and specimens of known Martian origin. Further future experiments on Mars searching for life might incorporate methods for testing for RNA in subsurface aquifers. It also changes the playing field for life in the solar system in general. Places that were previously seen as unlikely for life come onto the table. Two noteworthy candidates come on the table here. First is Io. Io is wildly volcanic and certainly has the needed glass and materials. It also once had as much water as Europa and the other Galilean moons of Jupiter. Some of this water may remain subsurface, which despite being actively volcanic may sport pockets of habitability below the surface. The other is the moon. Again, the moon has no shortage of volcanic glasses and may have had a period of habitability, or a layer deep enough and warm enough for water, where abiogenesis may have occurred. As to the universe at large, if the trend towards abiogenesis really being easy continues, then it will soon be safe to say the universe must teem with microbial life. It would be everywhere, with multiple bodies and star systems hosting it. And with over 90% of stars in the observable universe being habitable, and a great many of them sporting terrestrial planets, the numbers become staggering. It becomes possible that microbial worlds and moons may outnumber the stars themselves. And that creates the conditions for civilizations to arise. Another recent discovery was related to how complex life comes about. This was known as the prokaryotic to eukaryotic leap, and it seemed extremely unlikely and a very strong great filter. The reason is that the situation on its face seemed that the leap required an organism to absorb another organism and incorporate it without digesting it. That seemed to be asking a lot, and it might explain why it took life on Earth almost 2 billion years for this leap to occur. Recent findings, however, show that it may not have occurred that way, and in fact was a product of microbial symbiosis. In this case, you just need to wait long enough for a symbiotic situation to develop, and the leap occurs straightforwardly. It's also a case that Earth might simply have been a late bloomer in this regard. And there may be cases where the leap happens far earlier on most exoplanets and evolution gets fast-tracked. This scenario both raises the likelihoods of civilizations arising, but also offers the option that it may happen earlier on most exoplanets and Earth was just slow, defeating the argument that maybe we're the first civilization in the galaxy. But then there is the pesky Great Silence. This scenario leads to alien civilizations being very common, so where are they? It's also possible that Earth truly was early in the game for making the leap, and that as a rule, while the leap happens regularly, it usually does it on longer timescales, and that while occurrences of life are everywhere, very few of them have made the leap yet. This leads to a universe where the occurrence of intelligence radically increases as time passes. Another area where this model has implications is in the area of astrovirology. This is an area of astrobiology that's almost as spooky as the idea of hostile alien civilizations. Viruses are believed to have arose and evolved alongside life. Some of the most common viruses we deal with are based on RNA. The viruses that cause colds, influenza, hepatitis C, Ebola, polio, rabies, and even COVID are RNA viruses, and may trace their roots all the way back to RNA forming within lava glasses billions of years ago. But if that's the case, and life and viruses co-evolve, it may be that's the rule of the universe, and it's unsettling. Viruses on Earth vastly outnumber organisms, and that would imply that we do not live in a universe of life per se, that is secondary, but in a universe absolutely dominated by viruses. While that may seem a bit disconcerting, it's best to remember that viruses tend to be very specific, and can't infect every cell on the planet, just those of their specific hosts. Alien viruses would have no commonality at all, and we'd likely be immune to the vast majority of them, as we are here on Earth. That's unless a virus can generalize. This one is a long shot. Everything we know about viruses suggests that this scenario is highly unlikely, but it has been suggested in the annals of astrobiology, in the case of a dying world, such as Mars during the final days of it being a water world, where viruses could evolve to attack any cell they find. If so, it may be possible that dangerous viruses that can infect all life might be present on worlds like Mars, and should be checked for before returning samples or setting foot on them. Again, unlikely, but there are protocols in place for Mars sample return missions to check just in case. Yet another area where this model has implications is in the concept of a shadow biosphere. Here we would have a second genesis of life that coexists with an original genesis of life. How the model works here is that it may be that RNA is forming constantly on Earth, spontaneously under the conditions of the model. This raises the chances of abiogenesis occurring all the time, and that as new life arises, the first occurrence of life, our kind, snuffs it out. But it's also possible that there is a separate microbial biosphere on this world that we simply haven't detected because our means of detecting microbes is too skewed towards our type of life. This also offers a novel way to test the model. Find the conditions where RNA might be forming and check to see if it's there. It's possible that new RNA is formed constantly on Earth and has been since very early in the history of the planet. But there are still questions within the RNA formation model. The work shows ultimately that very complex RNA molecules can be formed chemically from very simple organic molecules that are almost guaranteed to have been present and forming in Earth's atmosphere during the advent of life. The model shows that very complex RNA molecules can form that are long enough to allow for evolution to begin and true life to arise. But questions arise about why all life on Earth uses only one of two possible chiralities, along with specific questions about nucleotide linkages. But overall, it seems that abiogenesis was not as complex of a process as has been suggested. Some of the models of how life could have arisen were getting increasingly unlikely to have happened on Earth, a phenomenon where something in science proves unexplainable, forcing the theories in ever more speculative and often unlikely territory. Then something comes along, like this model, that shows that the answer was simple all along. It's just that no one had thought of it. But within all of this, there is a rather eerie point. If abiogenesis proves easy as work on understanding it progresses, then the great silence gets even more deafening than it already is. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently a little spooked. If volcanic glasses were the birthplace of life, it's rather strange because among the first materials humans fashioned into tools is volcanic glass. So it could be said that it is also the birthplace of technology, making it in some ways the most important substance in the universe, common to all civilizations, both at abiogenesis and the moment they reach technology. Eerie indeed, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular, in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.